Whilst I was waiting, very still, and gathered into myself, the rock seemed to open its eyes. One image after another came forth out of the night, became alive, started to talk. The larger images sent out deep, powerful chords, and the smaller, ever smaller ones sounded a tender melody. At length, the whole space and the depth of that mountain was filled with a heavenly song of praise, which resounded up to the very heights, ever more distant and tender.
At that moment, Richard Wilhelm seemed to feel that no borders existed between the world he came from and the Far East. He translated Confucius, as well as the fundamental scriptures of Taoism. He was made famous by his translation of the I Ching, the Book of Changes. It remains popular throughout the world. Thus he brought ancient Chinese wisdom to the West. In 1899, Richard Wilhelm leaves for China as a young missionary. Throughout his life, he did not baptize a single Chinese.
Far off, I wanted to go, into life, away from the narrow world, where everything was certain and ordinary. And I began to wonder about this planet that we call Earth and the great riddles of existence. Why all this is as it is.
Richard Wilhelm was my grandfather. He died more than 20 years before I was born. His book stood in the shelves at my parents' home. Even though I was born in China, he long remained a stranger to me. Now, I'm looking for answers to the same questions that he had asked. In this city, on the shores of the Yellow Sea, Richard Wilhelm worked as a missionary for 20 years.
It was the early days of the small colony by the Yellow Sea, which was meant to be the gateway for Germany, when the big melon China was being sliced up and divided amongst the natives.
Today, Qingdao is a city full of contrasts. Many of the old buildings, relics from German colonial times, are still in good condition. Since 1898, Qingdao was a German protectorate. When Richard Wilhelm arrives in China a year later, in 1899, Qingdao is still a small fishing village.
In the first weeks, I have to make countless visits. It is strange when I, in top hat and kid gloves, hurry through the mud past a column of Chinese handcarts, often forced to leap over the water-filled drainage ditch to reach this or that house.
I traveled to China to find out how my grandfather came to understand so profoundly this treasure of Eastern wisdom. I want to see the places where he lived. To my surprise, I easily find out where the school was that he founded and his former home. Today, the school is called Middle School No. 9, but it also keeps Richard Wilhelm's Chinese name, Weilichen, the Lichen School. Even before I came to China, I'd started on a long journey. I was looking for experts who could enlighten me about the I Ching, an ancient text consulted for centuries by the Chinese emperors. And I wanted to find out more about my grandfather's life.
Remarkable man. So I didn't know what your grandfather was like as a person, but I really admired his work. It's funny, I'm working now on this globalization of the I Ching, and I'm very interested in to see, you know, Bob Dylan, the Beatles, name them, they all cite the I Ching, and they're all interested in the I Ching, and Dylan gets it wrong, actually, confuses a couple of trigrams with hexagrams, but I mean, you know, they're just moved by this. It's an alternative source of wisdom. It's countercultural, whereas in China it was clearly mainstream cultural. And, you know, secret societies, rebellious societies might use the symbolism, but, you know, everybody, every elite used the I Ching, everyone. And for these reasons, because it was just so illuminating, you know, again, the idea of the mirror of your mind, you know, that it will allow you to reflect what you're not even aware of. That's just a very exciting idea. Very exciting idea.
My interest in the I Ching deepened during an illness that put my future in question. I went to an authority on the oracle of the I Ching.
The first step is finding and formulating the question. What do I really want to ask? What is the deepest longing, the deepest impulse that lies behind the question? And if one takes the time to feel one's way into it, it is a rule that one can get far more out of the answer. As soon as one has found and formulated the question, the process of the oracle starts. And this consists traditionally in China of either throwing three coins or dividing a bundle of yarrow sticks according to certain rules. The throwing of the coins is repeated several times. The process of dividing the yarrow sticks is a bit more complicated. But in both cases, a specific combination of numbers is reached. It is this combination that invites in chance, leading to an image or hexagram which represents the answer to the question. The answers in the I Ching have always symbolic character. We never get a yes or no answer in the sense that one should do this or that. But we receive an image which opens up or illuminates our question in a new way. so that through the image we are led into a completely new way of thinking, a completely new way of understanding.
Well, my view is that the I Ching began as a book of divination. And so the what is sometimes called the basic text, with just the hexagrams and the judgment and then the line readings, that basic text is unquestionably a divination manual. And I don't think that there is any way you could think of it as a philosophical work. But the 10 wings that were added to it, I think, invest it with an explicitly philosophical orientation. And so there has always been a debate among I Ching scholars whether to view it as an oracle, as a divination document, or as a philosophical text. But the truth is, it's both and.
This portrait shows Richard Wilhelm as a young missionary at the beginning of his time in China. The artist, Zhou Hui, is drawing him for a book about old Qingdao. The German houses are still being built, and living conditions are primitive. It is the rainy season. This causes great discomfort to Richard Wilhelm's superior, Dr. Faber.
In the morning, I found my fatherly friend, the missionary Dr. Faber, sitting on a table that stood like an island in the pond that was the living room. He was painstakingly fishing for manuscripts and books that swam like lively fishes in the brownish water. I was greatly amused. But he complained bitterly that the mission had banished him into wilderness, where scholarship was impossible. From the start, Dr. Faber encouraged me to learn the language thoroughly. His invaluable translations and his understanding of Chinese remained a model for me.
During the first year of Richard Wilhelm's time in China, Dr. Faber dies of dysentery. From now on, he is on his own. But his interest in the old Chinese culture has been awakened.
As strange as it sounds, the old Chinese wisdom has the power of childishness, a harmlessness, far removed from ignorance or the primitive. It is the harmlessness of someone who is deeply rooted in his being, in the place where the sources of life bubble up. When, in ancient times, Bao He ruled the world, he looked up and contemplated the heavens. He looked down and contemplated the patterns on the earth. He proceeded directly from himself and indirectly from objects.
Bao He, sometimes also pronounced Fu Xi, was a completely mythological figure. But he was a figure that has had and does have a great deal of strength in traditional Chinese mythology. He was known for a number of things, but one of the most important was to invent the 8 trigrams. And the idea was indeed that he looked up in the heavens and saw these kinds of configurations, looked down in the earth and saw these kinds of patterns. And then from them extrapolated, you might say, into this system of these 8 trigrams that represent these qualities and powers of things like heaven and earth and fire and water and thunder and so forth. And so this is a way, I think, of describing the process by which, in a very comprehensive way, he managed to reduce all of the myriad phenomena in the skies and on the earth into these paradigms, these paradigmatic structures or symbols. So the eight trigrams then represent fundamental situations and forces and configurations. So the best way to think about them is that they are out there in the cosmos, unseen, but exerting influence. What happens still is that in the evolution of the I Ching, it appeared necessary to have a larger set of configurations, of situations. And so 64 hexagrams grow out of the eight trigrams. And they are seen then as archetypes or paradigms of situations that unfold in the universe. And so it would seem that just as eight are not sufficient, so 64 might not be sufficient. But what we have to remember is that in each one of those situations, the dynamism of the qualities of the trigram or the hexagram, the dynamism of the changing lines, produces an almost infinite number of possibilities. So within something that seems fixed, actually, there's a great deal of dynamism. And that's what accounts for the enormous interpretive range of trigrams and hexagrams.
The sequence of the trigrams illustrates the cycles that occur in nature, also the cycle of human life.
I was born on the 10th of May, 1873, at 1:30 in the morning. I was named Richard because my mother admired Richard the Lionheart.
Blumenstraße, the street where my grandfather grew up, was completely destroyed in the Second World War.
Grammar school was a time of gloomy chaos for me. For days and weeks, I walked about half in a dream. And I kept asking myself, what is this all for? I wanted to buy poison, tartar emetic, or whatever, in order to escape the dull atmosphere. But by mistake, I bought tartaric acid, which caused pallor and nausea, but no alarming symptoms. I had a dream. The graves were sunken in, and skulls and bones were strewn everywhere. And it was my task to discover why everything is as it is. I began to sink, as into a swamp, and my chest was constricted by deathly fear. Gradually, I regained full consciousness, and I realized that after my dream, everything was not yet over. I was still alive and had the chance to do it all differently. An indescribable sweet feeling of being protected filled me, and I prayed passionately, thanking God for giving me the chance to lead a new and meaningful life, and asking Him for the strength to follow it through. I started to put everything around me in order. I truly embarked on a new life. This turnaround resembled a conversion, but I kept this conversion to myself. I thus remained free from the dead forms of conventional piety.
In his diary, he writes about love that keeps his heart restless. He is now 18 years old and hasn't kissed a girl. One of his favorite places is the palace garden in Stuttgart, because of the statue of the Venus of Medici, the goddess of love.
She was a little larger than life size, so I had to step onto the head of a small cherub beside her. My heart pounded as I pressed a kiss onto her lips, which felt cool and strange. I felt a movement ripple through her limbs, a result of my own arousal. Another kiss. Then I let go and jumped down into the bushes, just in time. For at that moment, a park keeper turned into the alley. He surely would have had little sympathy for my romantic inclinations.
After graduating from the Protestant Theological Faculty in Tübingen, Richard Wilhelm takes up the post of vicar at Bad Boll. Here he meets his mentor, Christoph Blumhardt. The priest Christoph Blumhardt is a rebel within the church, who later joins the Social Democratic Party. Richard Wilhelm immediately feels that they are kindred spirits.
In Blumhardt, I encounter a free, powerful spirit. Everything narrow-minded and regimented, be it orthodox, pietistic, or whatever, is alien to him.
My grandfather falls in love with Blumhardt's favorite daughter, Salome. He draws portraits of her in his diaries. Although Christoph Blumhardt initially objects to their relationship, he eventually consents to their engagement. In 1899, Richard Wilhelm takes up his post in China at the Protestant Weimar East Asia Mission. 1 year later, Salome and Richard are married in Shanghai.
The noise of Shanghai was my first impression of China. Yet what I experienced here was not China. It was a compromise between the fixed rules of life brought here by the English and the thronged, rootless Chinese population of this harbor city.
I realize that some people respect me simply because I'm Richard Wilhelm's granddaughter. What makes his work so special?
The way ancient Chinese wisdom reveals itself is not through objective observation. One has to experience it, connect it with one's own destiny.
In Shanghai, my own history overlaps with that of my grandfather. I was born here. Because my grandfather went to China, my father was born here, and as a consequence, so was I. I set off in search of my birthplace.
Where are you? Bao Jing.
Bao Jing.
Bao Jing Lu.
Yeah, here, here.
17.
17.
Or 19.
Or
19,
70 or 90 at the upper side.
Yeah.
I think just write down here.
Number 19,
huh?
But this is number 19.
Yeah. This is number 19. And all rebuilt, you see.
Oh, they do.
Yeah. Oh,
that's the eye hospital.
Yeah. Eye. And, you know, limits.
My companion tells me he's 81 years old. What's his secret?
Psychological balance.
Yes. Psychological balance diet.
Yeah. You relax your mind. You see, kind to everyone.
Finally, he tells me the most important thing, to stay young. If you see suffering, share that suffering. If you see happiness, share that happiness. Be happy. His secret is that strength arises out of empathy for other human beings and in our relationship to the cosmos, which surrounds us all.
Man, in Chinese philosophy, and most of all, in the philosophy of the Book of Changes, is the mediator between heaven and earth. One speaks of the Trinity, heaven, man, and earth. Man in the middle embodies fulfillment as the highest flowering of the cosmic process. But at the same time, he is also the chief, being responsible for the development of the cosmos. And since he has such a major importance, all his questions, his themes are also of cosmic importance. For this very reason, he can find answers to his questions in the laws of the cosmos and of nature.
From the beginning, Richard Wilhelm is different to other Europeans. For example, the colonial rulers viewed the Chinese coolies as lazy, uncooperative and deceitful. And only with cuffs and blows could they be made to carry out their duties.
What I now discovered was that there were simply no coolies. They were all human beings who had to get by through cunning and endurance along straight and crooked paths. And all this done with cheerfulness and harmlessness when among themselves. This discovery opened up for me the way into the hearts of the Chinese people. No people are friendlier if one encounters them on human grounds without wanting anything for oneself, neither money nor exploitation through labor, or what they find most embarrassing, that they should convert in order to attain eternal bliss.
This way of seeing the people I also find in the photographer Ren Qihai. I met him in Qingdao because he attended the school founded by my grandfather. He showed me his photos. In 1900, social unrest is boiling up. The resistance is directed at foreigners, as the colonial rulers do not share their prosperity with the Chinese population. The result is the so-called Boxer Rebellion. The colonial powers send in troops to bloodily crush the revolt. Pardon will not be granted. Prisoners will not be taken. With these words, Kaiser Wilhelm II sends German troops to China.
revenge was taken on the hopelessly militarily disadvantaged Boxers. Now the victorious invading Allied armies did their best to show that brute force and cruelty on the part of the cultured nations was no less than what they had condemned with disgust in the Chinese.
There's also political unrest in Shandong province, to which Jingdao belongs. Here it is caused by the construction of the railway. Tracks are laid on fields where people have buried their ancestors in grave mounds. German troops are sent in to suppress the revolt. Richard Wilhelm's Chinese teacher, the eye specialist Dr. Li, makes it clear to him how much harm the troops are doing. The people don't understand the orders they are given, so the soldiers shoot at once.
Gemeinsam mit Dr. Li schaltet sich Richard Wilhelm als Vermittler ein.
Richard Wilhelm with Dr. Li intervene as mediators.
We treated the wounded and thus gained the trust of the people. With the German captain, I negotiated an end to the attacks. At length, we succeeded in bringing together the village headmen, over 100 of them, and explained the situation to them. Under my guidance, they then wrote a petition of surrender, which they handed to the captain, who then let them go, with some appeasing words.
After the end of the Boxer Rebellion, normal life returns to Jingdao. Christ Church, where Richard Wilhelm preached as part of his missionary work, is well preserved and is now one of the city's most popular sites. Association in Germany soon starts asking serious questions. It demands the establishment of a Chinese Christian community. But Richard Wilhelm refuses to baptize Chinese people.
So, as things are, the situation seems to require me to refrain from baptizing a congregation. It is my firm conviction that if we make distinctions between Christians and pagans, the hypocrites will push their way in, and honest hearts will be repelled. Therefore, I have baptized no one in China. It seemed to me better to concentrate on a simple life according to Christian principles, to act through schools and hospitals, to live together with the people, and to come inwardly close to them.
The Lichen School is inaugurated on the 20th of June, 1901. Richard Wilhelm also works with Chinese teachers, some of whom have received a Western education. Then a school for Chinese girls is opened. The building still exists today. My grandmother Salome teaches German to the Chinese girls.
Sie ist nun 23 Jahre alt.
She is now 23 years old and has two sons. Her younger sister, Hinde, teaches gymnastics. Besides teaching, they are also working to stop the girls from having to bind their feet. One morning, Dr. Joe calls me. He's heard I'm in Qingdao and wants to meet me. A surprise. Dr. Joe's grandfather was the first headmaster of the Lichen school, who worked very closely with Richard Wilhelm. He tells me how successful graduates of the Lichen school were. And here we sit. Two grandchildren, connected by their grandfathers.
And then you became a doctor in Qingdao?
Then we do what's actually the most important thing in China. We enjoy a meal together. The home of the Wilhelm family backs directly onto the yard of Lichen School. Soon these rooms will be renovated. But for now they still look as they did back then. I try to imagine how my grandfather created his great works here, the translations of the Chinese classics. His first published translation by the German publisher Diederichs is of the Analects of Confucius.
I think the true understanding of so alien a being as Confucius is only possible on the grounds of becoming lovingly engrossed in him and genuinely wanting to understand without prejudice. Across the world's many ages, I have met Confucius. Out of the jumble of the past and the poor things that have been written about him in Europe, he has appeared to me, completely alive in all his mild greatness.
Ich übersetzte seine Gespräche und wurde immer aufs Neue berührt von seiner Gegenwart.
I translated his words and was constantly touched anew by his presence.
Another of Richard Wilhelm's greatest achievements soon follows. His translation of the Tao Te Ching, the most famous Taoist text, which is renowned for its mysterious complexity. Its legendary author is said to be Lao Tzu. In order to better understand Taoism, Richard Wilhelm had long talks with the abbot of a small Taoist monastery. The monastery still exists today in the Laoshan Mountains, close to Qingdao. Taoism immersed itself in the mystery of nature and human existence without wanting to regulate them. Whereas Confucius invented an order for state and society which ruled life in China for over 2,000 years. Chufu. The hometown of Confucius. By the end of the Manchu dynasty, the old rules have become ossified. The government is weak and torn by intrigue. The military and the people revolt. Most of all, the selling off of the country to foreigners hurts their national pride. In 1911, the world of the old Confucian China, the world of the emperors, comes to an end.
Throughout the land, resistance to the emperor's house and its corruption grew. The rebellion against the ruling Manchu dynasty spread like wildfire. The air was thick with revolution, and its opponents lost their senses.
Sun Yat-sen leads a revolution against the imperial family. Pu Yi, the last emperor, is still a small child.
The revolution was an event of the greatest historical importance. It was as if the world was ending before our eyes. The old China, whose society and state had for over 2,000 years been rooted in Confucian thought, had collapsed.
China becomes a republic after more than 2,000 years of empire. A gigantic leap into a new age. And today? Are today's changes smaller? The photographer Ren Qihai is experiencing China's transformation at close range. His house, in which he had lived for almost 50 years, is being demolished.
There is something terrible about our times. The venerable established order that prevailed for millennia is collapsing. New questions and problems arise, which demand solutions for which the methods of the past are inadequate. But the great truth is that the harmony between nature and culture will remain and will give the new way to look at the world and the forming of man a strong, uplifting force.
During my journey, I encounter age-old rituals that are now enjoying a revival. Are they supposed to bring stability into a life full of change?
I've been doing some work now on Chinese Confucian temples, and many of them have quotations from the I Ching, and they are all about harnessing the power of human beings to do good in the world. That is a matter of what should I say? The good in the world is a matter of example. You know, it's, I mean, for most cynical Westerners, that seems impossible to understand. And so in a similar kind of way, the I Ching allows you with a certain kind of knowledge that allows you to behave in a way that will affect the future and affect the people around you.
Also in Richard Wilhelm's time, the old and new worlds exist side by side. Whilst the country is in the grip of the revolution, high-ranking imperial officials find refuge in the German protectorate.
Educated high officials who were prosecuted in Beijing fled to us in the German protectorate. The old men of Qingdao, as we call them, believed the collapse of Confucian China was a threat to the preservation of their knowledge. I had a dream. An old man with friendly eyes and white beard visited me. He called himself Mount Lao and offered to initiate me into the secrets of the old mountains. I bowed to him and thanked him. And he disappeared, and I woke up. Then, a few weeks later, this teacher came to Qingdao. His name was Lao. His ancestors came from near Mount Lao, and he resembled to the last detail the sage who had visited me in the dream. Master Lao suggested that I translate the Book of Changes. The living tradition was almost extinct, but he himself had a teacher who still was rooted in the old tradition. We did precise work. He explained the text to me in Chinese, and I took notes. Then I translated the text for myself into German. After that, I translated my German back into Chinese without the book, and he judged whether I had struck the right note in all points. Then the German text would be refined and discussed in detail. After that, I redrafted it three or four more times and added the most important commentaries. This is how the translation grew.
Master Lao died shortly after Richard Wilhelm had left China. His collaboration on the translation was his legacy. The ancient text of the I Ching, threatened with extinction in China, should now be made available to the Western world and thus preserved.
The I Ching to me is as important in the Chinese tradition, and maybe even in the East Asian tradition more generally, as the Bible is in Western culture, or the Quran is in Islamic culture, or the Vedas are in Indic culture, the Torah in Jewish culture. So I think in terms of its cultural significance in almost every realm, language, philosophy, religion, art, literature, social customs, music, in all of those areas, I think the I Ching has been every bit as influential as the Bible in the West.
In the early 1910s, Qingdao is thriving. Prosperity increases everywhere, and colonial life is in full bloom. In the meantime, the Wilhelm family has also grown. Salome and Richard have four sons. Wald, the youngest, was my father.
Things are going better than ever before. Our school now has 180 pupils, and the girls' school has 80 pupils.
And there is no shortage of festivities. Much to the disapproval of other stricter missions, Richard and Salome readily accept invitations. During a grand ball at the governor's palace, my grandmother causes a stir by wearing a so-called reform dress without a corset. Initially, the gentlemen were rather embarrassed, she writes, as they could only find my waist by touch. The onset of the First World War brings the blossoming life in Qingdao to an abrupt halt. Japan sends an ultimatum to Germany to hand over Qingdao. When Germany refuses, the Japanese attack. The families have to leave. Richard Wilhelm stays in Qingdao.
Er wird zum Leiter des chinesischen Roten Kreuzes ernannt.
He is appointed head of the Chinese Red Cross.
Both our home and the school are under fire.
Der ganze Hof ist von Blut, Trümmern und
The whole courtyard is covered in blood, rubble and torn cloth.
Kurz darauf dringt
This was the most difficult hour. Shortly afterwards, shrapnel burst through the roof of the upstairs room, where only a few minutes earlier, I had been observing the situation. Went to the police in the evening to arrange the burial of the dead. We get permission to bury them where space can be found. But the police have no one to spare, so we have to do it all ourselves.
On the 7th of November 1914, the white flag is hoisted at the observatory. The Japanese have conquered Qingdao. This is the end of the German protectorate. Many Germans are still interned in Japanese prison camps. When they and their families bit by bit return, they have to cope with a very different situation under Japanese rule.
Each person's fate is just a task that is put to him to work on. If destiny imposes a tragic situation upon the individual, a fracture always remains. The purest solution in such a case is to accept one's fate, even if it leads to death. Such a situation is described in the Book of Changes.
Das Wasser geht über den Scheitel.
The water goes Unheil. Over the crest.
Aber kein
Misfortune,
Makel.
But no blame.
It seems important to me
that all the time we should remain in a state of constant readiness for peace and prepare ourselves for this by freeing our hearts from blind hatred towards others. If one regards each expression of animosity or malevolence as a fixed, irrevocable fact, one will never rid oneself of bitter feelings.
In 1920, Salome and the children leave Qingdao and return to Germany. Richard Wilhelm follows half a year later. His works of translation have grown considerably. One of these is the butterfly dream of the Taoist philosopher Zhuangzi. In Germany, Richard Wilhelm leads the restless life of a traveling lecturer for the East Asia mission. He makes new acquaintances, amongst others, Hermann Hesse and Albert Schweitzer. The well-traveled Count Kaiserling, whom Richard Wilhelm had already met in Qingdao, founds the School of Wisdom in Darmstadt. It is a meeting place for progressive thinkers who seek inspiration in Eastern wisdom. Being an expert in Chinese philosophy, Richard Wilhelm becomes an important member. Here he gets to know Zige Jung, with whom he soon develops a friendship. Dr. Jung invites him to give a lecture on the I Ching Oracle. Jung is fascinated by the Book of Changes and later employs the Oracle in his therapy.
If one contemplates the I Ching as a book of divination, it is very helpful to distinguish between two kinds of oracle. There is a form of oracle that gives a definite prediction about the future over which I have no influence, and the things in the future where I do have influence. The I Ching is only concerned with the questions over what do I have influence and how do I have influence, and how can I understand what I myself bring to the reality and make this more conscious. So it is first and foremost about self-knowledge, which in so many ways affects how I shape my own destiny.
When one turns up as a missionary, one is simply seen as a kind of fairground attraction. People might even be more impressed if one came as an organ grinder with his monkey. The incredibly stupid rumors being circulated about China hamper any sensible understanding. In almost every vicarage, I hear stories about Chinese earthworms and rotten eggs.
2 years later, in 1922, Richard Wilhelm returns to China without his family. This time not as a missionary, but as a scientific advisor to the German embassy in Beijing. The China he encounters now is once again a country in transition.
The old is past, irretrievably gone.
Das Alte ist vorbei.
It was a beautiful world. All of us who were able to get a glimpse at it must be grateful. But now, let us march on into the heart of the chaos. Let us see to it that the chaos becomes creative. On no account should we stand still.
Richard Wilhelm's work for the German embassy in Beijing does not last long. After a short time, it has to be abandoned due to financial problems. During the early 1920s, he lives through a chaotic period with numerous revolts and counter-revolts. Warlords fight each other for power. Officially, the country is a republic. Despite the chaos, intellectual life in Beijing thrives. Richard Wilhelm encounters the most important thinkers of this turbulent new China, amongst them the reformer Kang Youwei.
I have, for the foreseeable future, accepted the post of Professor of German Literature and Philosophy at the Peking University. It is astonishing what has happened in the last few years. One faces a completely new world of modern ways of thinking.
The old Peking University building, the Beida, is almost completely preserved. Here he begins a long-lasting friendship with the chancellor of the university, Tsai Yuanpei. Later, he will even propose him for the Nobel Peace Prize. Besides teaching, Richard Wilhelm continues to work on his translation of the I Ching. He focuses deeply on its philosophy, but he also uses it as an oracle.
One of the reasons that Richard Wilhelm, one of the many contributions that he makes, I think, when he talks about the I Ching, is to talk about the degree to which we can order our existence through the I Ching, and that it doesn't, that order does not imply rigidity. I mean, the great insight of the I Ching is that we order our world, but then we establish our world. In fact, the Chinese have a great cliche about this. They say that our first impulse or our first priority is to 知命, to know fate. And then our role is to li ming, to establish fate. So in other words, we have this ordered existence, but we still have the capacity within it for infinite change as long as we understand our circumstances. But I think without that kind of order, it seems to me that creativity is impossible.
People congregate in Coal Hill Park and perform the rituals. I'm retracing my grandfather's footsteps here, following his daily route to the university. Supported by his private secretary, Liesel Bahr, who travels with him, Richard Wilhelm's enthusiasm for his work seems limitless.
Neben weiteren
In addition to further translations and his work of cultural mediation, he writes his childhood memoirs in Beijing. Despite his euphoric mood, financial pressure and the demands of his family make him decide to return to Germany. Saying goodbye to China, this time permanently, is hard for him. 1924, he heads home from Shanghai.
In China, one counts in centuries. This used to be the watchword of the old colonialists. But this has long ceased to be true. Today, life in China develops at a feverish pace. Each day brings new events and developments. And behind the noise of daily life, something tremendous is happening. The emergence of a new world. But the new is not something that comes into being suddenly. Its seeds and connections lie in the past. He who is able to interpret the seeds of what is becoming will be able to read the future from them.
Fundamental to the concept and understanding of the changes is the idea that all developments start in a barely visible zone. The good gardener will, when the plants are still relatively small, recognize and remove the weeds to let the desired seeds grow. This is an image to show how one should learn to distinguish what leads to right growth.
I thus carry on with my life. I must now leave behind faraway China and dive into this totally real, narrow-minded, dirty and eventful Europe and swim on through its muddy waters. This is nauseating at first, but it has to be. If the spiritual height one reached in the East doesn't give one the power to swim through the floods of Europe, then it is not real. But I do believe it is real.
In Germany, the financial crisis has deepened, and national socialism is dawning. At Frankfurt University, Richard Wilhelm receives the first chair of sinology. Some receive him warmly, but he also encounters a wave of hostility from the German academic world. His critics claim that his works are not scientific enough.
People scratch and bite one another. And one stands in the middle and does not know why.
These personal attacks are not restricted to faults in his translations. What provokes such a reaction? His intuitive way of dealing with the texts?
An intuition that contradicts logic is in reality not an intuition, but a prejudice. Intuition is in harmony with logic. It just goes further.
His intuition helped my grandfather to translate Confucius, Lao Tzu, Zhuangzi, Mencius, and other texts, and the I Ching, his magnum opus, which published in 1924 after 11 years of work. His vivid poetic language makes his books popular. Even today, they are constantly reissued.
This outstanding book, which seems to stem from the mists of ancient time, has saved itself through all the changes of the ages. And the most mature wisdom of life has accumulated around its text over 3,000 years and manifested itself in the form of commentaries and interpretations, a holy book, since it contains all the archetypes of a rich, creative life.
Hermann Hesse writes in a review, "In this book, from which I shall never get more than a glimpse, a system of allegories has been created for the entire world." Richard Wilhelm's text of the I Ching is translated into many other languages. Most of all, the English translation, initiated by C.G. Jung, becomes known throughout the world. In the 1970s, this Chinese classic inspires an entire generation, and people still look for guidance in the Book of Changes. They experience it as a liberation. Rather than being passively at the mercy of one's fate, one can influence the changes in one's life. The longing for China won't let thy grandfather go. He is now over 50 and often ill and exhausted. Nevertheless, he continues to travel in order to find sponsors for the planned China Institute for cultural exchange between China and the West. Finally, he obtains the necessary support, mainly from the Countess Sierstorf and the Swiss art collector Georg Reinhardt. Well-known artists of the time can be found on the board, such as the writers Gerhard Hauptmann and Hugo von Hofmannsthal.
So, the China Institute has been inaugurated. I sit for the time being in 1.5 cramped rooms in the Ethnological Museum. In the lower room, one can actually stand upright. In the upper room, more or less. The father of one of the museum's assistants used to store his hats here.
Here, Richard Wilhelm creates a vision of a new culture in which East and West are inseparably linked and reach out to one another.
There is but one truth throughout the world. The time has come that the great teachings of the East and West must stop being the special domain of a single country.
The inexhaustible search for the sources of deeper insight tightens the friendship between my grandfather and C.G. Jung. In London, I met Professor Sonu Shamdasani. For decades, he has studied Jung's work and published books on him. Now he has succeeded in creating a sensation. Thanks to long years of work and persuasion, he has launched a document which was kept secret for many years. The Red Book. Here, Jung documents his innermost visions. He writes and paints whatever bursts out from his deepest unconscious.
He was the book of his soul. His painting is unfinished.
It is such an intimate document that Jung had doubts about publishing it during his lifetime.
That's beautiful.
I learned that one of the mandalas in this book has great significance for his relationship with my grandfather. Whilst Jung is painting it, he receives an ancient Taoist text from him, The Secret of the Golden Flower.
Wilhelm sends it to him, asking him to write a commentary.
Yeah.
It's not just, here's something I found you might be interested in. It's, he explicitly invites his collaboration on this text. Jung abruptly stopped the transcription of the text of Liber Novus into the calligraphic volume and decided to leave it to one side. But what struck him was the parallel between the mandala he was painting at that time, which he felt had a Chinese character, and some of the conceptions in The Secret of the Golden Flower. It gave him a confirmation of his ideas, that there were other people elsewhere engaged in similar practices, coming up with similar conceptions. He could relate to something outside of himself. I think Jung himself makes some comments on this.
In the epilogue of the Red Book, Jung writes, I have worked on this book for 16 years. The beginning of the end came in 1928, when Wilhelm sent me the text of the Golden Flower. Here the contents of my book had found their way into reality, and I could no longer go on working on it.
In a letter that Sege Jung wrote to Richard Wilhelm, he said, fate has made of us two bridges to link the East and the West. So they had a conception of a shared destiny. That's what drew them together.
It is no accident that I, coming from China, found in Dr. Jung a European with whom I have much in common. Independently of each other, Chinese wisdom, as well as the insights of Dr. Jung, have descended into the depth of the human collective consciousness, where they have encountered entities that look so similar to each other, because they both truly exist. This seems to prove that truth can be reached from every point of view, if only one digs deep enough.
Jung writes the introduction to Richard Wilhelm's translation of The Secret of the Golden Flower. The book is about the immortal inner essence, the Golden Flower, which can only be developed by special meditation techniques. One of the mandalas Jung shows in his foreword without mentioning his name is the Golden Castle.
In the Book of the Yellow Castle, it says, in the inch-wide field of the foot-wide house, life can be ordered. What else could it be but the heavenly heart? The Confucians call it the center of emptiness. The Buddhists call it the terrace of liveliness. The Taoists, the land of the ancestors, or Yellow Castle.
End of the 1920s. Political chaos intensifies. In Frankfurt, as in the whole of Germany, people's anxieties grow. Hardly anyone pays heed to my grandfather's messages. Nevertheless, he goes on working without taking care of himself. But his strength is diminishing.
I have found very strange signs in the I Ching. These signs correspond to these difficult times and to the situation I find myself in at present. I hope that it will be possible to live through these times in a way that the difficulties will bear fruit on a higher level and that they just mark a pause before new progress on a spiritual level.
After a series of lecture tours, he suffers a severe recurrence of an intestinal disease. His physical resistance weakens due to continuous loss of weight. But also in the city hospital of Frankfurt, where he spends most of his time, he continues to work. His illness, the tropical disease Sprue, remains undiagnosed. C.G. Jung visits him at his sickbed. Afterwards, he writes, in his dreams, he was once again on the endless path of the desolate Asian steppes in an abandoned China. One might understand Wilhelm's problem as a conflict between the conscious and the unconscious, which in his case presents itself as a conflict between West and East.
The fact that I am ill is easily understandable when one thinks more deeply. I cannot afford to be healthy with my fateful connection to China, when China is in as bad a way as it is now.
Was my grandfather's illness the price he paid for becoming so deeply immersed in a foreign world? The Soul of China is the title of the book in which he describes his experiences there. Did he leave his soul in China? On the 1st of March 1930, Richard Wilhelm dies at the age of 56 in Tübingen at the Tropical Institute. He is buried in the cemetery of Bad Boll. The 8 trigrams that are the basis of the I Ching surround his grave. In the dark times that led up to the most horrible of wars, my grandfather was not much listened to. The world has since changed. East and West have grown closer. Is today a better time to hear him?
I saw the world in its changes. Saw the water flowing with the river. Eternally changing and always the same. Only the times in which it transformed itself were a little different. But I stood, after all, on the shore of eternity. What does time mean?